100 years ago, 1970, castes in India, their mechanism, genesis, and development. Dr. Bimal Ramji Ambedkar presents his critical evaluation of the various characteristics of caste. Baba Sahib's critical evaluation leaves no doubt that prohibition, or rather the absence of intermarriage, endogamy to be concise, is the only one that can be called the essence of caste when rightly understood. Fast forward 20 years, 1937, annihilation of caste. Speech prepared by Dr. Bimal Ramji Ambedkar for the 1936 annual conference of the Jatpat Torak Mandal of Lahore, but not delivered, owing to the cancellation of that conference by the reception committee on the ground that the views expressed would be unbearable to the conference. In this speech, which Baba Sahib tells us he intended to, but didn't find time to incorporate into his earlier paper, Ambedkar teaches us that the real remedy for breaking caste is intermarriage. Nothing else will serve as the solvent of caste. Some 70 years later, just over a decade ago, 2006, the Supreme Court of India endorses Ambedkar's real remedy. In the matter of Lata Singh versus state of Uttar Pradesh and another, Justice Markandi Kathew asserts that intercaste marriages are in fact in the national interest, as they will result in the destroying of the caste system. Now, given Baba Sahib's critical evaluation, and given Baba Sahib's real remedy, it may come as a surprise to you to learn that in a letter dated 27th of April 1936, a letter to Har Bhagwan of Lahore Society for the Annihilation of Caste, Dr. Ambedkar confesses that, well, the real method for the annihilation of caste, for breaking up the caste system, was not to bring about inter-caste dinners and inter-caste marriages, no, but to destroy the religious notions on which caste was founded. How then can we make sense of Dr. Ambedkar's argument in annihilation of caste? What is Baba Sahib telling us to break? Must we break our practice of marrying only within our own kinship group? Or must we break the religious notions on which caste was founded? Well, we must break both. Now, to understand how Baba Sahib can reach both conclusions at the same time, we need to grasp the distinction that Dr. Ambedkar makes between the source of a social disease and the script to remedy it. If Dr. Ambedkar challenges the Society for the Annihilation of Caste, you have located the source of the disease, but is your prescription the right prescription for the disease? What Dr. Ambedkar meant by the source of the prescription is clarified by what he says immediately before and immediately after the words I've just quoted. So immediately before the words I've just quoted, Dr. Ambedkar says to his audience, "You are right in holding that caste will cease to be an operative force only when interdining and intermarriage have become matters of common course." Clearly, Ambedkar here agrees with his audience that lack of regular and frequent interdining and intermarriage is the sustaining source of the disease that is caste. Absence of intermarriage keeps caste going. But what is blocking intermarriage? What is the barrier between us and it? Well, immediately after the words I've just quoted, Dr. Ambedkar challenges his audience with the words, Ask yourself this question. Why is it that a large majority of Hindus do not interdine and do not intermarry? There can only be one answer to this question, replies Baba Sahib. And the answer is that interdining and intermarriage are repugnant to the beliefs and dogmas that the Hindus regard as sacred. Caste, explains Baba Sahib, is not a physical object, like a wall of bricks or a line of barbed wire which prevents the Hindus from commingling, and which has, therefore, to be pulled down. Caste is a notion. It's a state of mind. The destruction of caste does not, therefore, mean the destruction of a physical barrier. It means a notional change. Thus, ultimately, Ambedkar is less committed to marital change than he is to notional change. Although he argues that the real remedy for breaking caste is intermarriage, a closer attention to the nuance of Ambedkar's text reveals that the right prescription for the disease that is caste is the destruction of the notional barrier that still stands between us and intermarriage. So what exactly is this notion? Now, although the notion whose destruction Ambedkar identifies as the proper prescription is religious and is Hindu, it need not be. Dr. Ambedkar thinks that caste ranges much more broadly than Hinduism. For Ambedkar also deploys his philosophical concept of caste beyond Brahminical domination. For example, he argues that there was a social problem between in Ulster and Southern Ireland, the problem between Catholics and Protestants, which is essentially, he says, a problem of caste. The philosopher John Stuart Mill agreed with Dr. Ambedkar. In 1825, Mill argued that the opponents of Catholic emancipation are willing to degrade 5 or 6 millions of their countrymen to the condition of an inferior caste. I think the word caste here is being used as much more than a mere metaphor. We have to remember that James Mill, in Mill's father, in 1818, wrote the influential History of British India, and both father and son spent the majority of their working lives working for the East India Company. Strikingly, much later, in 1865, when commenting upon the American Civil War, John Stuart Mill identified one thing he hopes will be considered absolutely necessary to break altogether the power of the slave-holding caste. It sounds like something Baba Sahib might have said. So I want to explore with you what I think is a very similar notional barrier that still stands between, in the way of intermarriage with that former slave-holding caste, that still stands in the way of intermarriage with that caste of persons racialized as white. Now, in his book, Is Marriage for White People? How the African-American Marriage Decline Affects Everyone, Ralph Richard Banks argues that the Supreme Court's 1967 decision in Loving versus Virginia, a case involving the marriage of a black woman to a white man, that decision invalidated the prohibitions of interracial marriage that remained on the books in more than a dozen states. After Loving versus Virginia, interracial marriage became legal throughout the United States. Yet, in an article entitled The Aftermath of Loving versus Virginia, Sex Asymmetry in African-American Intermarriage, Ralph Richard Banks argues that the most noteworthy feature of the post-loving period is the sustained low intermarriage rate of black women. Why do so few persons racialized and gendered as black women marry a person racialized and gendered as a white man? Ralph Richard Banks gives us the following answer. If fears of interracial intimacy keep people separate now, it's because those fears embody the echo of the past. Many of us continue to act out the roles we first began to inhabit long ago. We scarcely stop to consider that we might change the script. Thus, Banks assumes that it is within the power of those persons gendered and racialized as black women, unilaterally, of their own accord, to change the script. In her article, Don't Lecture Black Women About Marriage, LaToya Peterson argues that it is not within her power unilaterally to do this. Falling black marriage rates aren't the result of black women's being picky, Peterson argues, but rather the complex politics of attraction. Indeed, to imply that black women is the reason for the current state of affairs is grossly simplifying the complex politics of attraction, particularly in societies that value some types of beauty more than others. In actual fact, it is persons racialized and gendered as white men who scarcely stop to consider that they might change the script. We can expose this by analyzing the behavior of persons racialized and gendered as white men in communities designed to allow daters to look for a marriageable match. This white male behavior demonstrates that black female agency is not dispositive as a cause of the sustained low intermarriage rate of black women. There are three aspects to this white male behavior. What they state in their personal advertisements. Whose personal advertisements and unsolicited correspondence provoke a positive response from them. And what expectations they express in their positive responses. Now, because I have little time, I'll focus on the third. But if you're interested in finding out more, please do take a look at the dissertation that has already been mentioned. It's called The Duty to Miscegenate. So, it might be thought that the private conversations about sex, marriage, and companionship that occur between individual persons are unobservable. Well, not so. In an unexampled experiment, the social psychologist Jan Lebija placed three bogus advertisements, personal advertisements, in two French magazines, varying only in respect of one word. Each advertisement read as follows. Very beautiful, young, black, mixed race, blonde woman, 26 years old, would like to meet a man to share fun times and more if we're a match. Only detailed letters will receive a reply. In total, Lebihan received 872 letters from persons racialized and gendered as white men. Labiha used software to calculate how frequently certain words are grouped into themes recurred among the letters. Labiha found the following. A. The blonde woman received the greatest number of letters. B. The woman of mixed race received fewer overtly sexual letters and a significant number of letters from wealthy, middle-aged professionals who saw in her a potential trophy wife. C. The black woman was seen as the woman of third choice. Not only did she receive the fewest replies, 237, that's 27.2% of the total, she received replies of inferior quality from persons who tended to present socioeconomic impairments that might inhibit them from participating in sex, marriage, or companionship with either the blonde woman or the woman of mixed race. Those persons tended to be older, on the rebound, unemployed, income poor, and uncultivated. Indeed, they tended to be rural and to request that the black woman engage in agricultural work. Most significantly, their replies to the black woman tended to be sexual as opposed to marital. Only she received naked photographs. Words suggesting a demand for sex were more frequently found in replies to her. Only she received sexually explicit replies to an advertisement under the rubric of marriage. These white male expectations are the real notional barriers between our white-dominated society and intermarriage with the black woman. I think it is a similar notional barrier, Brahmin male expectations, that stand in the way between Brahmin-dominated society and intermarriage with the Dalit woman. Let's return to Dr. Ambedkar's analysis of the endogenous essence of the caste system, which has two aspects, he says. In one of its aspects, it divides men into separate communities. In its second aspect, it places these communities in a graded order, one above the other, in social status. Yet, as Trani Pillai Becerra argues in her chapter Ambedkar's Daughters, a study of Maha women in Ahmednagar district of Maharashtra, endogamy does not separate or grade men so much as women. According to Pillai Becerra, caste ranking within the system depended to a large extent on the sexual purity of women. Each community tried to control female sexuality through rules and regulations, very strict ones among the high castes and less severe ones, permitting more freedom to women among the lower orders. That word there, freedom, is a euphemism. It's a sham. As Meena Kandasamy put it in her article Celebrating the Allowed Slutty Sensibility, in our country, when a man chooses to abuse a woman by calling her a whore or a slut in any of the regional languages, he attaches a caste epithet to the slur. Needless to say, such an epithet almost always carries a reference to one of an untouchable caste or another. In Brahmin-dominated society, the Dalit woman is reduced to an identity, to a thing, to a word. In white-dominated society, the black woman is reduced to an identity, to a thing, to a word. In Brahmin-dominated society, the Brahmin male expectation is that the Dalit woman is a slut. In white-dominated society, the white male expectation is that the black woman is a slut. These are the notional barriers. And we see this in how one Dalit woman and how some black women have responded to a social movement called the slut walk. The slut walk was a local and thereafter global movement reaction to the following words uttered on the 24th of January 2011 by the Toronto Police. Women should avoid dressing like sluts in order not to be victimized. On its website, the organization Slut Walk Toronto replied that the word slut is being reappropriated. We are asking you to join us for Slut Walk, to make a unified statement about sexual assaults and victims' rights and to demand respect for all, whether a fellow slut or simply an ally. You don't have to wear your sexual proclivities on your sleeve. We just ask that you come. In her article, Meena Kandasamy argues that slut walking might not save any or all of us. After all, the patterns of discrimination against women here in India are far more vicious than in Canada. And they are intricately entwined with the massive oppressive structure of caste. Indeed, Kandasamy criticizes this Brahmin-dominated society that maintains a studied silence when it comes to the culture and of impunity that gives caste Hindu men the entitlement to rape and murder Dalit women at will. Slut walkers, Kandasamy tells us, are fighting against shame because it is an oppressive tool in rape culture. But here in India, she says, a woman does not have to live long enough to be raped to learn its acid test. She does not have to wait to be shamed till she turns a slut. It begins at birth. Now similarly, in an open letter from black women to the slut walk, posted at Black Women's Blueprint on the 23rd of September 2011. The invitation from Toronto is declined. The many often distinguished signatories to the open letter, who name themselves as the undersigned women of African descent and anti-violence advocates, activists, scholars, organizational and spiritual leaders, say that we know the slut walk is a call to action and we have heard you. However, they give the following reasons for declining this invitation. Even if only in name, we cannot afford to label ourselves, to claim identity, to chant dehumanizing rhetoric against ourselves in any movement. Feminizing. The word afford here is key. If I can afford to do something, I can do that thing without running the risk of adverse consequences. Indeed, the signatories say that we don't have the privilege to walk through the streets of New York City, Detroit, DC, Atlanta, Chicago, Miami, LA, etc., either half naked or fully clothed, self-identifying as sluts, and think that it will make women safer in our communities an hour later, a month later, a year later. In other words, the signatories cannot afford to show off their bodies, to represent their bodies publicly and ostentatiously in a sexually explicit way, sexually eye-catching way. Similarly, the word dehumanizing is key to our understanding of the argument of the signatories. For they say we cannot self-identify as sluts when we're still working to annihilate the word ho, which deriving from the word hooker or whore, as in Jezebel whore, was meant to dehumanize. Thus it is the threat of dehumanization that is a threat of having one's status as human ripped away, that leads stripped away, that leads the signatories, and that leads Meena Kandasamy to conclude that they cannot afford to participate in the way that they have been invited to participate. Dehumanization is the adverse consequence that persons racialized and gendered as black women risk if they show off their bodies. As Sidney Fontaine Lewis puts it in her doctoral dissertation, Looking Forward to the Past, Black Women's Sexual Agency in Neocultural Productions. Whereas the word slut has historically been used to shame white women into normative categories of sexual behaviors, black women have historically never had access to these normative categories. Although black women have doubtlessly been called sluts, the word has functioned differently, not as an aberrant to a chaste norm, but as a generalized description of black womanhood. Not only has the word slut functioned in white male-dominated society as a generalized description of black womanhood, the notion of slut has also functioned in Brahmin male-dominated society as a generalized description of Dalit womanhood. In each society, the mainstream way of communicating about their human bodies unjustly disqualifies them as sexual sluts who are unfit for marriage. This, then, is that notional barrier between our societies and the intermarriage that will break caste. I'll end by leaving you with the words of the artist and activist, Josephine Baker. In her autobiography, the autobiography she co-wrote with her husband, Joe Bouillon, Baker was a North American person racialized and gendered as a black woman. Bouillon was a French person racialized and gendered as a white man. They were married. Yet even Baker still tells us to be wary of that notional barrier. Berlin. I found it dazzling. The city had a jewel-like sparkle, especially at night, that didn't exist in Paris. The vast cafes reminded me of ocean liners powered by the rhythms of their orchestras. There was music everywhere. Word of our success at the Champs-Élysées had preceded us, and we were greeted with great excitement. There were even rumors that the show was indecent. An impression I may have strengthened when a reporter asked me to describe my ideal world. One where we can all go naked, I replied. I was quick to add that few of us can afford to show our bodies. Thank you.
Thank you, Natalie, for that vibrant and thought-provoking discussion. We can have a few questions before we start the next session. We'll have it together. Shubhi is a doctoral candidate at the Center for Political Thought, JNU. She'll be talking about the lack of academic studies about intersectionality of caste and patriarchy in Indian academia. Shubhi.
First of all, I would kind of extremely sorry because I was late. I was stuck in something. I would like to first thanks Babsa, who has invited me to share my thoughts on this topic. BAPSA is an organization in the campus who has always talked about alternative politics, you know, though there are like many parties like, you know, here, like, as I've been kind of, you know, watching, like, you know, they do take Ambedkar's name, they kind of appropriate him, but like, you know, hardly they kind of, you know, focus on his very central ideas, you know, which are like, you know, very crucial, you know, to kind of show that how the humiliation and discrimination which happens in academics, you know, how it works, you know. It is very important to see, as understand Ambedkar's ideas in this regard to understand discrimination. I would like to thank Nathaniel Adams, who has come to enrich our thoughts here, and then to Steve Van, who is chairing the session. My paper will explore the question of patriarchy in Indian academia, which is basically to understand as to which patriarchy is talked about in academia and which is not, and if not, why. To understand how academia has dealt with the question of patriarchy, one has to look into the ways the debate on caste, sexuality, masculinity, agency, Brahmanic patriarchy, Dalit men, Dalit women, reservation, like debates, like, you know, around all these, you know, topics has taken place, you know, in order to understand this question of patriarchy. Brutal neglect of Ambedkar's writing, I would argue, especially should be seen as the way through which Savarna academia has evaded the question of patriarchy and caste in India. My PhD topic was to explore the question of gender in Dalit community, like understand, you know, what is their idea, how do they understand sexuality and masculinity and all that, you know. So like I have come across like so many articles on caste, sexuality, masculinity, and like, you know, I have hardly found that, you know, they have tried to relate their arguments with Ambedkar's analysis. Very few have done, and if some has done, they have kind of, you know, have not taken the effort to name Ambedkar. Like they have used his analysis, but without naming him. I should also mention that this is not a very exhaustive paper, because I had been kind of given a very short time, and I will just kind of mention the literature which I have been going through as to what I found as to how this question of patriarchy and caste has been evaded. Babasaheb Ambedkar was the first thinker who argued that endogamy, which is the most real and prominent manifestation of caste, could only be maintained and sustained through the direct control of women's sexuality. His concept of racial inequality, a mechanism deployed by Manu, reveals that the control on the sexuality of women varies according to their caste. His analysis shows that various stages were involved in the evolution, mechanism, and the spread of caste in India. To understand caste and patriarchy in its entirety, one has to see as to how, Ambedkar has kind of, in his origin and mechanism and development of caste, he talks about two things. Firstly, he says that it is through sati, enforced widowhood and child marriages that the caste was created and preserved. And on the other hand, when he explains that the reason for the spread of caste, when he talks about the reason for the spread of caste in India, he gives two explanations for it. One is psychological and other is mechanistic, and argues that they are both necessary and complementary to understand the formation of caste in India and its spread. By psychological, he explains as the infection of imitation of three customs among the non-Brahmins. I am bringing in this point as to understand what Ambedkar has talked about, as to giving us some hints as to into the, this patriarchy. by this he's suggesting that imitation of patriarchy, how does it functions among how it has from the Brahminical this thing, how it has come to the non-Brahmins. And it is also very important to mention that here in this psychological explanation, he just only talked about that how non-Brahmins have kind of imitated this patriarchy, and he does not talk about untouchables, it seems like, in this argument. The second explanation which he gives about the spread of caste in India is a mechanistic interpretation and talks about the mechanism of excommunication. This process of excommunication, it is like, you know, as I have went through the literature of Baba Sahib, you know, his revolution, counter revolution, riddles. This is a very complex process, like mechanism of this excommunication. There is this term which is there, which is called Varnasam Sankara, it talks about the mixed caste. So basically, Baba Sahib says that mechanistic interpretation is basically how the mixed caste are created. This is also like this creation, the mixed caste are created and in this creation, his mechanisms were such that the lower caste women were coerced into perpetual slavery in 18 and 19. So thus, on one hand, the control on upper caste women's sexuality as I have understood that these three customs sati, child marriage, and ban on this thing, widowed marriages, though they were very oppressive to upper caste women, but in a way this has not led them to getting them exploited by the other men. But on the other hand, as this excommunication process or the creation of mixed caste, which I've not taking the text here right now because it is a very complex and very elaborated thing in Baba Sahib's literature. On the other hand, in the creation of caste, this mechanism of creating mixed caste, has given Dalit women a kind of identity which is very exploitative. Which also suggests that in the religious literature, within their exploitation begins with the emergence of caste. And this is how we can understand the existence of differential violence that we witness today on these two groups of women. The differential control of women's sexuality facilitated the bad women, good women dichotomy. Given this forced identity on lower caste, can we argue that conditions were created for lower caste men to imitate patriarchy in order to get rid of this caste patriarchal oppression? This also suggests that women are not a homogeneous whole, thus questioning the feminist sisterhood argument which they highlighted in their literature when they talk about oppression in women. Well, this argument was mobilized to evade the question of caste and its relationship with patriarchy. In the articles, the Indian feminist movement, and the literature which they have produced, it has been criticized of being very Brahmanical in nature, not treating all women as one and, generalizing their oppression. Applying this analysis of Ambedkar in understanding the question of patriarchy and its links with caste is completely absent in the academia. This analysis of Ambedkar clearly clarifies various doubts. Ambedkar's reading of Hindu law clearly revealed that the sexual violence on women was graded in nature and public exploitation was reserved for Dalit women. The change from Pitasavarna to Matrasavarna, this he talks about in one of his riddles, reveals this change, which has been imported by Manu, gives a free hand to Brahmin men in exploiting lower caste women. But how does this open prostitution or devadasi sanctioned by Manu's law is debated upon in academia? This change from Pitrasavarna to Matrasavarna, it talks about that how the varna of the child has been decided upon. Earlier, the varna of the child was decided according to the father's varna. But then Manu made a change and he said that now it has to be the mother's varna. But nowhere, it is that the child is given the varna of the mother. So it is Baba Sahib says this is forcing Dalit women to into a sexual slavery, where Brahmin men can have free sex and they are not even responsible for the child which is coming up. But how? Okay, so now like I will kind of talk about as how this question of this of prostitution and devadasis, which is sanctioned by Manu's laws, how it has been debated in academia. They, like many feminist writers, they portray it as providing economic independence, property in some case, higher ritual and social status, as a matter of choice, stressing towards the agency of lower caste women. Jenny Rowena critiques this and asks how in a society which preserves endogamy, cherishes it, can celebrate this lack of endogamability as agential and empowering. The agency argument is a constant reminder that how lower caste women are portrayed as liberated and as when compared to upper caste women. Generally, it is argued that their engagement in prostitution due to their low women has taken up prostitution because they come from very low economic this thing and they have no money to, and that's why they have entered it. What I have kind of found that this argument rests on the intersectional analysis, which argues that various other oppression compounds the suffering, which is to say that Dalit men is not only oppressed by her caste but also by her gender and class. This kind of analysis treats various oppression as if existing in isolation, separate from each other, and that no one has a relation with the other. Thus, prostitution has nothing to do with the caste but with class. Kanika Sori, like one of the members of Roundtable India, like where Dalit women writers, they send their articles and all, she writes that what does intersectional analysis do to the theorization of Dalit women exploitation? She writes that what it actually does is that it adds another layer of smokescreen to the already well hidden caste or savarna class in the Indian political landscape. The intersectionality stick is always used, police, oops, theorize gender violence, and that goes down in the community. Neatly, the gaze of caste is fixated on the marginalized communities, and intersection has turned into a point of political opportunism, where Savarna women and the male lackeys can infiltrate the Bahujan politics and try to create a space for themselves with a view to safeguard their interests. Caste is once again slabbed on our community. It is as if caste does not inscribe Savarna women gender oppression at all, and intersectionality is something that they can champion only by looking and magnifying misogyny in certain communities. Can Savarna women talk of intersectionality up without bringing up the Bahujan women as their lab rats? Asked Kanika. It is clear the Savarna women picked up this analysis from black women politics, giving the impression that they have engaged with Hooks, Collins and other writers. But this is not true. Anurang Das, editor of Roundtable India, stresses that black feminist critique black patriarchy only after creating a solid framework of white supremacist patriarchy. And white feminists have no disagreement with the way patriarchal power flows from white male downwards. Here in Indian academia, there is no recognition of patriarchy as power linked to structure. They are trying to explain patriarchy from bottom. How can power be explained from below? How can you make sense of Dalit patriarchy when we know nothing about Brahmanical patriarchy? How can the power flow from bottom? In the absence of Brahmanical supremacist patriarchy scholarship, Dalit patriarchy study is not feminism but racialization. Racialization, the articles, like if anybody like who has been kind of engaged with the AKW articles, like or other articles on caste and sexuality and this thing, like most of the time, like, except the one book from Manoj Chakravarti, Brahmanical Patriarchy, I have noticed that they are very, the academia is very obsessed with Dalit patriarchy. And they never bring into question as to the source of it, as to talk about the origin of it, the origin of caste. Baba Das Sahib has stressed about, which will tell us as to how it has originated and how it has came down. It is in this scenario, Ambedkar's analysis of origin of caste becomes important, but there are two problems here. On one hand, like I have already mentioned this, that we see a complete reluctance of Indian feminists to engage with Ambedkar's ideas in understanding caste, patriarchy and gender in India. And on the other hand, some have used his ideas to build their theories on class and patriarchy without even naming Ambedkar. Like, and Uma Chakravarti could be one of them. And when I was reading Sharmila Rege's book, which talked about Madness of Manu, like in somewhere in the quote, Sharmila Rege has mentioned, you know, though Uma Chakravarti, if I'm not wrong, Uma Chakravarti has not given any credits to Baba Sahib in when she talks about how Brahmanical patriarchy has come up and what are the mechanism and all in controlling the sexuality of women. But it is Sharmila Rege who then says that Uma Chakravarti has kind of borrowed and from Ambedkar and all that. Okay, so it is the responsibility of feminists to talk about patriarchy. We don't see male Savarna academicians to engage with this question, though they have tried to explain the phenomena of caste. But very shrewdly given an economic explanation where caste is looked as a form of division of labor, a way of organizing labor, or either they have accused their colonial master for the spread of caste. They have done that basically to hide the oppressive nature of caste and the fact that it is in defeating Buddhism that the caste has solidified. The writings of white scholars on caste have further facilitated the Savarna academicians in mystifying caste. But this mystification is not very easy to capture, for it is they, the Savarnas, who organize the talks on caste and patriarchy. They decide the theme, the sub-theme, the selection of participants, even they also control the question and answer session sometime. I can give you like one very recent example, like, you know, which happened, like, conference which happened in Bangalore, you know, the people, like, I could not go there, but I was following it on Facebook, you know, live thing, and I could see Lord Bhikkhu Parekh. I don't know why he uses Lord. Bhikkhu Parekh was there, and then Ashish Nandi was there. We are aware of Ashish Nandi's story, and Bhikkhu Parekh was the one, like, who kind of, you know, as Meena Danta, like, you know, she was telling that it was Bhikkhu Parekh, like, who kind of negated that, you know, that in UK caste exist, you know. But these kind of people, they are kind of invited there in the conference. And largely we were aware that it was a Congress initiative, you know, because the elections were coming and all that. This shows that Ambedkar can be appropriated and pressed to advance the agenda of caste, for they claim that Ambedkar is not just a Dalit icon. They can talk about Ambedkar without engaging with the central idea. The story does not end here. In the bid to show that how much they wanted to engage with the question of caste and oppression, the Savarna women, like, I also give one other example, you know, I found this article on Roundtable India where she talks about, there is this writer, I have not mentioned the name here right now, sorry. She talks about when Angela Davis, she was invited to the Anuradha Gandhi Memorial Lecture, and the topic she was given was to talk about black lives, Dalit lives, histories and solidarities. So the article mentioned that, you know, that the people who went there, they were expecting from Angela to kind of, you know, talk about how, you know, as she was kind of, you know, into this movement and how she was aware that the movements get appropriated and all. But it, Davis did not spoke about this. And then secondly, what was noticed is that, like, you know, in the question and answer session, you know, among 60 questions, 4 questions were selected, and one of them was about Dalit patriarchy. The article mentioned this tendencies, like, you know, these kind of, you know, in the academia, you know, when where they have all the power, you know, to select, decide, to ask, to kind of, you know, dismiss, you know, they were completely unchecked, as from the publishers to writers to panelists, they largely are upper caste. Very selected topics are covered under the rubric of caste and violence. The gift talked about, which the title was Men in Global South. In this, you know, the issues of masculinity and patriarchy are talked about, and, like, you know, very short sections were given, you know, talking about the, you know, various countries, you know, and their men and how they are, you know. And in this book, I found an article which was entitled The Abusers. It talked about how, the article was titled Abuses, and the writers were S. Anandi and J. Jayarajan, who have already kind of, in an APW article, they have written about Dalit masculinity. So they have reproduced this, but the title was changed, The Abusers. in this day, like, you know, this article has, talked about as to how, you know, Tamil, like, Nigerian society, you know, when the young Dalits have achieved economic power, you know, how they have become oppressive, not only to their own women, but also to the non-Dalit women. And very strangely, the article claimed that, you know, it has made the upper caste men to kind of control the mobility of their own women. Like, how we can clearly see that how the it is, the logic of, you know, the oppression is completely inverse, and also that, you know, that how the book allowed, you know, to be, you know, have this title of the abusers, you know, stigmatizing the whole community. These things go uncontested as the caste solidarities prevent them from questioning each other, and thus they are never made accountable. One can notice the obsessive compulsion among the authors to understand the domestic violence in Dalit communities. But they basically, most of the time, like, this talk about Dalit patriarchy, why it is done, why it is, like, you know, again, you wanted to see the personal. Like, you know, why don't you question your own complicity, you know, when it comes to a campus, when it comes to a college? Why don't you ask as to why we don't have, you know, kind of, you know, more kind of SC professors and women professors, you know? This is the argument which has been made by one of our friend on the round table India. As to, and secondly, this kind of, you know, obsessiveness with Dalit patriarchy is also to kind of somewhere say that, you know, that only somewhere they negate that, you know, the public patriarchy does not exist, you know. I don't, somehow they wanted to give this impression, you know, with this public patriarchy, you know, it is this which kind of, you know, exploits Dalit women, brutally. So, what is the kind of effect of all these things, you know, when in the academia and all that, when they do these kind of things and kind of, you know, not completely talk about us to their origins and reject Baba Saheb's idea, what is its effect on Dalit students, you know? So, like, in either kind of, you know, they have to kind of spend like tremendous amount of, you know, time, you know, to understand exactly what is the right argument, because there are so many counter arguments and all that, you know. Say so, and even if they come up with their own analysis, like, I don't know if it is kind of accepted, not accepted. I don't know. It is not considered very original. The other things that that has been kind of, you know, I was just discussing with a friend, and she said that, like, you know, that how caste is only present even in the topics that, you know, that are given, you know, to Dalit women and all that. They are kind of, you know, somehow brought into this, you know, idea of, you know, studying the violence within their own families. So, to escape, like, in the end, I just wanted to mention that to escape this academic oppression, one has to completely base his argument on Baba Saheb's articulation in various aspects. Thank you.
About the absence of intersectional analysis, as well as about the normalization of Savarna women's identity in this literature, and the need to think about patriarchy in as layered and as graded, as much as you think about womanhood as graded and as discriminated according to different stratifications. The floor is open for discussions. We can have questions.
Subhi, you said intersectionality has been racialized racialized or in a very in our own context, it has been appropriated in a certain way. So how do we, what in terms of articulating our own politics, what would be the normative grounds of articulating a new understanding of intersectionality, or how do we see intersectionality itself?
Thank you.
As I talked about that, in case of talking about the oppression which Dalit women face, why intersectionality cannot work, or as you have asked as to how it can be understood, that this kind of what does it say? It says that there are different factors of oppression, caste is there, this is there, and they don't see it as interlinked, they don't see it as interlinked, rather. They kind of, this I'm saying why as to, when it is, this argument is, put, that it is because of the class, that the women are taking up prostitution. No, this is to reject the idea that, that it is their caste which has kind of, which has given this low class position, and it's because of this that they're going into this, in the prostitution, It treats intersectionality, treats these as different and not interlinked, So we have to see as to the source, what Baba Sahib has been stressing, by talking about origin.
Afterwards should be this. So I think it's also about the, when you talk about patriarchy, for instance, you talk about gender as if it's, that's a singular category of oppression, right? So that results in the universalization or normalization of women's identity as one, as grouped as one together. But the ways in which patriarchy operates is graded, and it's kind of discriminated against different kinds of women in different ways. So there is this need to kind of denaturalize what is seen as the normalized universal identity of a woman or a man. So in that sense, even when there is literature about patriarchy by upper caste feminists, there is a larger need to acknowledge the privilege through which that patriarchy works, which kind of, so intersectionality is not just about talking about Dalit women, it's not just about Dalit and being a Dalit and a woman, but it's also about, according to every layer, religion, in terms of religion, caste, what needs to keep on denaturalizing those normalized categories. So maybe Subhi was kind of feeding into that kind of a discussion which was talking about intersectionality.
But the intersectionality has always been applied to understand the oppression of Dalit women. As if for the upper caste women, intersection doesn't apply. Their caste and gender, they never kind of intersect. They don't have any explanation for that. I don't know why.
So I think it's important when we talk about the theory of intersectionality or of intersectional experience, intersectional injustice, that we remember where this knowledge was produced from. Subi has mentioned some campaigns that you have here with regards to increasing the number of ST, ST, OBC professors, not just students. We have a similar campaign, or have had a similar campaign in Britain, Why Isn't My Professor Black? But we've moved on from that campaign to a campaign, Why Is My Curriculum White? I guess you might have a similar campaign, Why Is My Curriculum Savannah? The idea being here is that Professor Kimberley Williams Crenshaw's production of the knowledge about intersectionality is something that we still struggle 25, 26 years after she first introduced this terminology to establish on the curricula of postgraduate, undergraduate school syllabi. I mention that in order to try to disrupt the way in which we remember how this knowledge was produced. Now, intersectionality today, where it is discussed in Britain, in the United States, is often discussed without relation to where it came from, without relation to its origins. So people in popular discourse will, if they are prepared to talk about intersectionality, and I'll talk about those who aren't, the majority, if they're prepared to talk about intersectionality, they'll talk about it without reference to black women, without reference to the intersectional position of poor black women. If they're not willing to talk about intersectionality, they'll probably say that intersectionality is a long word, difficult to understand, it's jargon, it's highfalutin. I'll say something about how we should deal with that response in just a moment. Supi mentioned that intersectionality sees, different axes of oppression as separate. And this is not actually how we experience oppression. Professor Kimberly Williams Crenshaw was dealing with a legal system when she wrote the paper, or the two papers in which she advanced intersectionality of the theory. It was dealing with a system of law that sees, and in fact our systems of law in Britain and in the United States still see these axes as separate, discrete, such that they need to be brought into an intersection. They're not already at an intersection. And this is a very troublesome and problematic way of viewing oppression. We're already at the intersection. It's not that roads have to be brought into an intersection. The nature of oppression. The other metaphor is the metaphor of the basement. Professor Crenshaw invites us to consider a basement below a ground floor. At the bottom of the basement, there is a line, a sort of row of people who are discriminated against on all the many grounds on which one might be discriminated: caste, race, gender, disability, religion, gender identity, pregnancies, and so on. And then on the shoulders of the people who are standing at the bottom of the basement is another row of people who are discriminated against on the basis of all those same oppressions except one. And then similarly for another level of the basement, similarly until you get up to the top of the basement where there is that last row of people whose heads brush against the ceiling of the basement. They're discriminated against on only one factor. There is a hatch in the basement ceiling through which those people at the top level are permitted to enter so long as they can prove to the person in the ground floor room above that but for this one thing, I too would be in the floor above. I too would be in the room where there are people who are discriminated against on no grounds. What does this offer us? This metaphor offers us, I think, a movement away from what Catherine McKittrick has called a flat geography of power. The intersection is a flat geography of power. Power, social power, is about people being on top of each other. Just like Baba Sahib said, graded one on top of the other. I urge you, as you think about how to, and whether to, of course, as you know, it's been raised, incorporate the metaphor of the intersection into your discourse here in India, to think also, go back to the roots of Professor Kimberly Crenshaw's writing, and think also, and think with greater priority about the metaphor of the basement.
Since nobody are asking, so I have one question to Nathaniel. Nathaniel, it is very interesting that you are bringing the black question to Dalit question. So I have one observation from caste India genesis mechanism and development, where actually Ambedkar tried to convince us that it is the Brahman, the male, the Brahmin male, actually perpetuate caste. And the rest female, they have to bow down, they have to actually accept it. If you take the contemporary example in India, take any of the examples, it is the female, irrespective of caste, has to follow the male, right? So, and it also, it can be actually look at in Islam and Christianity in India, that actually female has to follow the male. Take the surname one example. Our best example, just our brother mentioned, Aishwarya Rai. Aishwarya Rai is no more Aishwarya Rai, see Aishwarya Bachchan, right? So similar example also available in Christianity and Islam. I don't know about the black, I don't know about the white, whether this kind of problem exists there or not. This is one curious, because then only I think we can actually extend Ambedkar idea of male domination to a larger extent and theorize that how it is the male only perpetuate notion of inequality, notion of subjugation and discrimination and so on. One thing.
You mentioned this kind of program and the Sharia. I think I lost the thread of what you said at that point. If you could just repeat what you said, I'd be grateful.
It is this.
Yes,
this train class, the male becomes the perpetrator of caste to a large extent. Because he was giving this example of how women take the names of their husbands after marriage.
Ah,
so
across caste.
Across caste. It is not the male or not to other, I mean lower caste. It is across caste. And example is available to us, it is actually the upper caste women. They do not look at this question at all. Rather, they just go down, take it, accept it.
So, is that very
is
that the case?
So, there is marriage occurs, continues to occur, and even though marriage is, quite frankly, a deeply cis-heteropatriarchal institution, and women who participated in Britain, in the United States, do sometimes assert resistance to the cis-heteropatriarchy of this institution by doing such things as retaining the name that they were born with after the marriage. This is an act of resistance because the name that is usually taken by a woman according to the tradition of marriage is the man's name, and the woman's name of birth is later referred to as her maiden name. Also, some couples are engaging in forming double barreled names, putting the name of the man and the name of the woman prior to the marriage together with a hyphen, and call it naming their children with this hyphenated double barrel name. That's also a way of resisting it. Names have a particular valency here in Brahmanist society. There is a sense in which some names in white society have a valency. Some names can be associated more with the aristocracy, but the sort of valency where some names are immediately used to identify people as Dalit, I don't think that occurs in British or American society, so I don't think a similar rejection of Dalit names or of names of people associated with those racialized as black would occur. I mean, frankly, my name, I'm someone racialized as black, and my name is frankly the name of someone racialized as white. A slave owner, a plantation owner, who named an ancestor of mine, because by naming people you identify your ownership over them, you brand them, and hoped by naming my ancestor and knowing that my ancestor would produce children, that he would also own me. So that's why I put a strike through my name. Has that answered your question? Okay.
No, actually, what Subhi said, I think we important, what I found after reading the debates on the intersectionality, at least in the context of caste and gender. Like she said, like there is no link, and the discussion is on mostly on the superficial ground. I also feel like the entire debate on the intersectionality in the context of India has somewhere helped sovereign up both men and women to basically protect themselves or to protect their privilege of not talking about their own self. For example, if you see the entire intersectionality debate, Savarna women is someone who enjoys both the patriarchal privilege which is sourced by Brahmin patriarchy and also being a Savarna women and upper than the both male or from the lower caste and female from the lower caste. Now therefore what I sometimes think this entire academic debates on the intersectionality, which has kind of have not paved the way for the lower caste to come up with the autonomous debate. Rather, it has basically kind of helped Savarna to theorize Dalits and other lower caste. So, and therefore, there is a normative understanding, there is a normative way to understand Dalits. If you take the example of JNU, last time the one beloved professor, Dalit professor by most Savarna people in JNU like such professor. He kind of made a comment by showing a documentary finally. Then I think many of us must have watched that movie. And in the last scene, the Dalit boy, with a lot of frustration, he throws the stone to the upper caste people. And after the movie, all these Savarna women in the classroom, they start talking about this is how Dalit masculinity works. And this Dalit professor, he is very happy to discuss all about it. See, now my point here is that the entire debate on gender and caste, or what we are talking about, the white patriarchy and the Brahmin patriarchy has not came into the fore or have not discussed completely, is also because Dalit man in the academics. Because what I believe Dalit men, mostly in the popular academy, somehow is also depend to for his popularity, for his for his maintenance, he is also completely depend upon the Savarna male and female both. So my argument here is in this so-called liberal academic discourses which should be mentioned, here the problem is both Savarna male and Savarna female. They both are powerful than Dalit male also, and therefore because Dalit male has more accessibility than Dalit women, he comes to the academics, and therefore this entire discourse of the intersectionality somehow is helping both Dalit man to maintain his position, Savarna women and also the Brahmin male, and therefore somewhere I believe that we need to go beyond this debate of intersectionality, this normative. I think we need to, think about to create something more autonomous understanding, where we don't need this, theory of intersectionality which does not provide any explanation to understand the Brahmin patriarchy or the Savarna women privilege. Subhi.
Also wanted to mention, that this engagement of Savarna women with this theory, is very, very partial, as I mentioned. How this whole theory, this thing, how in what context it has been developed, they have just not dealt with the context. It's just, they have just kind of, picked it up and kind of, pasted, to understand the reality. So it is very limited, understanding on account of, Savarna women.
Yeah, This theory of intersectionality in India, like caste and gender, that's what I'm saying, does not provide any ground to understand the Brahmin patriarchy. I don't see any account, for example, you have number of autobiographies of Dalit women, Devi Dai Kamde, Hira Bansode, and so many. I haven't seen a single Brahmin woman who is talking about patriarchy at her place. That how would the Brahmin men perpetuate the patriarchy or maintain the hierarchy? I haven't seen a single biography in that academy. So I am saying the entire debate of the intersectionality somehow is basically protecting the savannas to, you know, to kind of hide their own privileges. So I think we need to go beyond this.
So I think that it would be misguided to throw the baby out with the bathwater. One might think that conversation hitherto up to this point, both from myself and Subi, but certainly from me, has focused our attention upon the white man or the Brahmin man and the Dalit woman or the black woman, and has missed out overlooked the Dalit man or the black man or the white woman or the Brahmin woman. And you might think that because we focused in one area that, and we used an intersectional framework to do that, that we won't or can't focus in the other area, and we can't use an intersectional framework to do that. I push back against that and say that, well, I haven't been able to speak about all the ways in which intersectional justice, injustice works. And frankly, intersectional theory does provide us with some tools with which we can identify the intersectional injustice of the position of the white woman, and perhaps even, I would suggest, the savannah woman, and similarly, the black man, the Dalit man. One thing that occurred to me when you mentioned, Subi, the law, I guess a change in the law from how the caste status of a child would be understood. It used to be that a child would have the caste status of a father, and then a law came in to say that the child should have the caste status of the mother. This made me think of a law that was brought in the Chesapeake in Virginia and Maryland, the beginning of the colonies of Britain in North America. A law in the late 1600s, a law that was described in Latin terms as patur sequitur ventrum, patus sequitur ventrum, the offspring follows the womb. In Britain, it was the standard practice that the child inherits the status of the father. In the Chesapeake, in their plantations, they realized that, well, in fact, we're occupied with and focused on something else. Certainly, with regards to black women, we don't want the children of white slave masters and black women after sexual assault, rape, to inherit the status of the white slave master. No, we want them to be owned by the slave master. But we also want to protect the wounds of white women. White women are the vessels through which we maintain the purity of the white race. This theory that the status of the child comes from the status of the woman also had an impact upon the way in which white men treated black men. So you will have heard of lynching. Lynching is a system of social, non-legal, extra-legal justice that is meted out on people who are suspects, thought to have done something wrong, but usually have, standardly have not. And it's still going on today. The killings that we see in North America and Britain are rightly described as lynchings. Lynchings of black men were invariably on the grounds, the supposed grounds, that these black men had engaged in some sexual impropriety with a white woman. Why was this important for the white men? Well, for the white men, the wombs of white women were the vessels of white purity. Only white children could or should come from a white woman's womb. And a black man was a threat to that. Why am I telling you this? In order to point out at least one of the ways in which intersectional thinking, intersectional theorizing, can begin to help us understand the injustice of the social status that is the white woman. And the injustice experienced, at least to some extent, of those who occupy the status of black man. So don't throw intersectional theory out with the bathwater. Do engage with it critically. Do look at other aspects of Professor Kimberley Williams Crenshaw's theory, including the basement, and try and harness it for your own struggles.
First, I agree with Nathaniel regarding not to throw the baby out of the water. I would urge people who are criticizing intersectionality to read Kimberley, as he was suggesting. She's not a white woman, she's a black woman. She's a professor of law at UCLA and also at Columbia University. Read her, understand, and develop your own intersectionality approach. Then only we can address these. The question is to Nathaniel. See, I've been reading a lot about some of these African American philosophers in the current generation, whether it is Charles White Mead's Epistemology of Ignorance. One of our faculty here, who just left, he has developed a new theory of protected ignorance. It's similar kind of explanation. But what I'm not able to understand is that now we know about history and current struggles against injustice, for justice, in various parts of the world. But with your experience in the US, UK, in India, why do you think that there is no a larger network for solidarity, for global justice kind of thing? But why there is no even attempt to bring together, to forge solidarity, to learn from each other's experiences? Why that kind of thing? And it is taking place, but at a very small level. I fail to understand why it has not. Because if something happens here, no solidarity comes from there. Blacks are not able to understand America so far, then they are stuck with Gandhi. As Martin Luther King was projected as someone who was highly impressed by Gandhi, Mandela, highly impressed by Gandhi. Never ever heard that Mandela talked about Ambedkar. And I don't know whether he knew about Ambedkar or Dalits or not. But outside the country, outside India, whenever you hear about Gandhi, not about Ambedkar, even in the black movement, Gandhi is more popular, perhaps for several other reasons. But why do you think, personally feel, that what are these stumbling blocks?
Thank you for your question. There are at least three things that you mentioned: ignorance, global solidarity, and the G word. I hate to give Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi any airtime in a conversation about Bhimrao Ramji Ambedkar. Frankly, I think that man has had far too much airtime. But I will say this, it strikes me as amazing that African descended people still cling on to that